So when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. Whoa. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will.
So let's go ahead and start. We're going to go to Genesis chapter 5, and we're going to start in verse 18. Father, thank you for your word. I ask you, bless this word. God, I ask that it goes forth and it accomplishes what you sent it forth to do. It will not return void to you. And God, I pray, Lord, that the stirring of the Spirit of God happens this morning in our lives and our hearts and our minds. In Jesus' name, amen. Jared lived 162 years and begot Enoch. So Jared is Enoch's father. And after he begot Enoch, Jared lived 800 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Jared were 962 years, and then he died. So we see Jared, you know, we're going through the genealogy, and this happens a lot in the Bible, especially in the book of Numbers, one of the boringest books you'll ever read. I remember, God, can I just get a pass? You know, because when you actually read the whole Bible, you're like, I read the whole Bible, and you tell people. And then sometimes I really wonder, I'm like, yeah, right, what about Numbers? Did you really read that one? Because you can't get very far until you start going like, oh my gosh, what are we trying to figure out here, you know? But in this scripture, it's really interesting. As you're reading, you get, there's little nuggets, right? Little things that God can show you. So it says, all the days of Jared were 962 years and he died. So he lived, he had kids, and then he died. So here is Enoch. Enoch lives 65 years and then he had his first child, and that was Methuselah. After he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and then he was not, for God took him. Now it's believed that Enoch had a very special and unique relationship with God. Right? It wasn't a relationship with men. It was a relationship with God. Just like you see all throughout the Bible with Moses, David, Jeremiah, all the prophets. These were men who were set apart and they were holy unto the Lord. And they had this desire to know their God, to have a relationship with him. Not just know him, but be known by him. There's a scripture in the New Testament that talks about many will come to me in that day saying, Lord, Lord, didn't we do this in your name? Didn't we do that in your name? And he says, depart from me, for I never knew you. Now, God is omnipotent. He knows everything. He's omnipresent. He can be anywhere at once. And he knows us. But there's something about interacting with God that God wants us to actually begin to open up our life and have intimacy with him. And that word into me, you can even say, into me, see. Into me, look in my life, know my heart, know my ways, know my thoughts, and judge them whether they be wicked or pure, and let me live my life in such a way that's pleasing to you that you would show up and show me who you are and use my life in an awesome way. Right? It's not just for, oh, those pastors and those preachers or those men of God, they're just special. Well, they're special because they chose to pursue God. And the ones who don't, it shows up eventually in their lives because they're really not living for that intimacy with him. They're living for the whatever, the fame or the fortune or some sort of notoriety or acclaim, right? I don't want to be in ministry and serve God because I'm looking to be some sort of famous person so everybody can applaud and be like, you're so great. In fact, real ministry will do the opposite because you're going into people's life and you're kicking the enemy out of their lives, and that stirs up the spirit realm. So the enemy starts attack, right? You get people backlashing, saying stuff. The devil will rise up. You'll see it in your life. As you begin to press into God, you'll start seeing a separation happen. The people you used to hang out with, they probably won't like you as much. Unless they're willing to go with you, they'll actually begin to be the ones that try to distract you and pull you back to live a life of foolishness. Or sin. And this morning, I really want to inspire us that you matter to God. You personally. And he wants you to have such a relationship with him, like a David or a Jeremiah, that you would be so close and in tune with God that he could flow through your life and use you in an incredible way. Speak through you. You lay hands on the sick, they recover, right? It's not just, we don't go out empty without God not knowing him and then try to go, right, pray for people because there's no substance there. What's the thing we're missing? We're missing God. We need God and his empowerment, the Holy Spirit, and we need to have that connection with him so that when we begin to move and preach and teach and lay hands on the sick and challenge the devils, then they actually respond because it's God's Spirit working through us. There's a story in the New Testament about the seven sons of Sceva, and they were, they were kind of like, posers, right? They were trying to do the work of the ministry, and they go out there try to cast the devil out of this guy, and he's like, I know Paul, I know Jesus, but who are you? And then that demon whooped them, and they ran out of the room naked. I don't know how that happened because it doesn't make any sense to me. I don't know what kind of deliverance that was. But all of a sudden, they're just, right? Because the person of God wasn't really in their life. And see, that's what God wants to show you this morning. And also challenge you that you would really know that it's one thing that he's there, right? He's almost like a guardian angel, like watching over you, like where he's just kind of aloof. But there's a difference when you wake up and he speaks to you. Before you go to bed, he talks to you. You feel his presence. There's this intimacy. Right? Intimacy. If you've been married for very long, if you and your wife don't have intimacy, guess what? You're not going to have a fun marriage. Right? It'll be cold and dry. Right? The bitterness can creep in. But see, when you have intimacy and you begin to share and open up and you get to know each other, your love and your commitment deepens and grows. It's the same thing with the Lord. So I'm going to start we already started, but let's go to this next scripture. Isaiah 22, and we're going to start in verse 15. And you're going to see a prophetic word coming towards a specific man, and he's not living for God. He's got a position, but he's not truly connected, and God's judgment is coming against him. And this is the way we can be in our life. You can live for God, or you can live not for God, right? You can have a great position. We see this in our government. You have men who've been voted into power by people, and some of them are godless. They don't care. They have an agenda, and they vote people in power for their purposes and their cause, and some of them are not godly. They're evil, and they're wicked. We see it in our society, and God wants to remove those and replace them with ones that love him, ones that know his law, who actually respect and honor his law and want to see it, right, obeyed and because it brings peace and love and fruit, godly fruit in people's lives. When you disobey God, you're inviting destruction. There's a scripture, I actually woke up with this scripture. I'm going to read it real quick. I woke up at like 4 in the morning, and I went into my living room, and I was just wide awake. Have you ever had that happen? And you're like, what the heck? It's 4 o'clock in the morning. I could be sleeping right now. But you know, it's like there's just no way you're going back to sleep. I'll just lay there for whatever. So it's like I just got up, I went in the living room, and that John 10:10 popped right into my mind, and it says, "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they," who's they? You and I, "may have, and that they may have it more abundantly," life. "That they may have life." What is life? It's not just you breathing air and walking around. Life is the exhilarating experience of living with and for God because you were created by God, and you can't truly have the fulfillment and success and feel joy and that thing that everybody's looking for, right? They're looking for it in other things, and they get, right, that hole they're trying to fill. God created us to live and to walk with him. And when we do, it brings an abundance of life. It brings a fulfillment. It doesn't allow for the enemy to come in and steal and rob through sin and disobedience and deception and, right, secret things, secret hidden agendas of the heart. People can be wicked and look at their neighbor and wish they die or feel, you know, get mad at somebody and have all these wicked emotions. But see, when you have God in your life, his holiness and who he is begins to purify and challenge those ugly things that happen in our life, in our hearts. And as we deal with them, his promise is, I'm going to bring abundance. I'm going to bring abundance of joy, abundance of peace, abundance financially, where God can bless your life. God never called anybody and said, hey, I want to use your life, but guess what? I want you to be poor and have to be suffering. Even the prophets of old who were out there, he would provide for them supernaturally. Sometimes it was daily, but they were walking in such a faith walk that it allowed for God to move in specific ways in their life. It became a testimony of who he is. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, my provider. Amen. All right, Isaiah 22:15 says this. Thus says the Lord of hosts, go, proceed to the steward, to Shebna, who is over the house, and say, what have you here and whom have you here, that you have hewn a sepulcher here? As he who hews himself a sepulcher on high. So he's beginning to have this pride, just like the devil, right? This pride and this arrogance begin to creep in, and he creates this sepulcher, and which is kind of like a staff, you know, of rule, who carves a tomb for himself in a rock, right? It's like somebody, you know, it's one thing for people to honor you and say, hey, let's build a statue and put it right here and recognize this person, right? Or like we have this memorial park here where you see all these veterans here in Gainesville. You go visit. And that wasn't obviously done by them because they're all dead. But people were honoring them and they created a memorial. Well, this guy was creating a statue like if somebody did for themselves and be like, here's my great statue, right? And put it up. That's a difference than it's other people honoring you and building a statue. So God's seeing, and it's grieving him because this man has a position, and it's supposed to be right in his kingdom and his with his people, but this guy's not living for God. Almighty man, and will surely seize you. He will surely turn violently and toss you like a ball into a large country. There you shall die, and there your glorious chariot shall be the shame of your master's house. So I will drive you out of your office and will call my servant Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and strengthen him with your belt. I will commit your responsibility into his hand, and he shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder. So he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open. I will fasten him as a peg in a secure place, and he will become a glorious throne to his father's house. So you see the promise and that key of David being mentioned. And that key of David, when you think about a key, you think about authority. You think about, you know, keys are for doors. Keys are to open doors. Sometimes, you know, if you get a job somewhere and you have a higher position, and they'll give you the key to that building, and they'll say, hey, this is a part of your responsibility. They give you that authority to be able to open and to lock that door, right? Open or shut it. It remains open and remains shut based on the authority that's been given to you. God has given us the key of David, and I'm going to go in here and I'm going to show you what that means, because I believe it means, right? David had a heart after God. And the key of his was actually to God's heart. And when you have the key to God's heart and how to please him and love him and worship him and adore him, it brings God's authority and his positioning in your life to where now you start thinking different, acting different, living different. You start looking at life differently. Man, I'm on this earth not because my parents birthed me, but I'm on this earth because God has a purpose and a plan for my life. Amen. Let's go to Revelations. We're going to see this key of David mentioned again in Revelation 3. We're going to start in verse 7. He's writing to the church of Philadelphia, and he says, these things says he who is holy, who is true. He who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. He says, I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. So there's something about, see, when we go back here, and I'm going to sit here for a second because I want you to see something about this letter that's to people, to a church, that where God says, I know your works. I see your passion. I see your commitment. I see your dedication. I see that you're genuinely all in for me, that you're not just playing a religious game. In fact, he says, I'm going to expose those fake Jews. And I believe that can be said today about those, right, fake Christians. Christians that are just Christians in appearance or in their white, they say things with their mouth, but in their heart, they truly don't love God and love people and are pursuing how to minister to people. You know, when people come into this place, when we're believers, we should not see them and see all their shame and all their stuff and be repulsed by them. We should have a heart that's open that says, oh, I see somebody in need of Jesus. I see somebody who needs a touch from heaven. How can God use my life in this person's life? That should be the thoughts that go in our head, right? We shouldn't look at somebody and then be like, right, who's that? Who's that? Look at what they're wearing, right? We can be very judgmental and critical, but that's not God's character in us. That's the flesh. God's character wants us to see people. And let me tell you, we meet some pretty, you know, crazy people, especially in ministry. You'll meet some people that are different. You'll meet some people that are just flat out weird. Right? But in the flesh, you're like, ugh, get away from me, weirdo. But see, do you think Jesus would do that? No, Jesus sees and he has eyes like fire that sees into their heart, sees where they were broken, sees where they were abused, sees the pain and some of the things that they're going through. And he wants to give us those same eyes and that same heart. But it doesn't come flippantly. It comes at a price, and the price is relationship. The price is seeking him and pursuing him, spending time with him, spending time in his word, allowing his Holy Spirit in, filling us with his gifts, praying in the Holy Spirit, getting outside of your natural fleshly way of thinking and getting into the Spirit and allowing God to give you a spiritual mind. So let me keep going with this scripture. He says, because you have kept my command to persevere. So this is one of the positive letters. You know, most of the letters, some of them are pretty scary. But this one, he's encouraging them, and they have a perseverance, and they're actually in it, and they're in it for the real way. There's nothing there that's hidden. It's like, I'm all in, God. I'm here for you. Whatever you want to do, however you want to use my life, I'm in it with you. I will also keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world. The ones who what? Are close. The ones that are genuine. You know, this idea that God's just up there like, I sent my son, he died for you, and that's all that matters. Ha, la, 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 la. And now we're just like, hey, I have Jesus, and I'm just going to do whatever I want, however I want. And every time I feel a little guilt or shame, then I pray, right? Or I go, you know, to some booth, and I go and I have to confess and talk to some guy who's probably living in some kind of sin himself. No, we're gonna get before God. We're gonna come to the altar. We're gonna confess our sin. We're gonna lay it bare before God and say, God, use my life. Whatever you want to do, have your way in me. Have your way with my life, with my children, with my family. Whatever correction, whatever, right? Sometimes, you know, when you're going through some of that challenging time, it's hard to invite God to change you, because you know sometimes that change is painful. And it's not necessarily like physical pain. Sometimes it hurts our pride. It hurts our like ego. Like my ego, oh, you got to humble yourself. Sometimes people, you got to admit that, oh, that guy was right. And some of us, we don't like admitting when people are right. You know, some of us, especially when we're in our marriages, which you got to learn how to admit when somebody's right in a marriage. Because if you can't, it's going to be the thing that breaks it. You got to learn how to yield and surrender to one another, like the Bible says. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. And I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So you see a reward, a heavenly reward for going all in with God. You know, the people of old that had this commitment and this passion to stay connected to God no matter what, through the trial, tribulations, through the storms, there's a benefit and a reward. I think when we get to heaven, we're going to see some of those rewards, like for the men of God, right? There's a lot of times people say, I can't wait to get to heaven. Who do you want to meet? I want to meet David. I want to meet Moses. And sometimes I think, is that how that's going to be? Because I'd be like, man, I want to just run to God's throne room and just be like, oh, God, right? Just be close to him. And maybe that's what happens when you get there. You just see everybody just worshiping and just spending time with God. But see, while we're on the earth, it's almost like this whole thing's been designed to really, truly, right? Because there's sometimes I get frustrated. It's like, God, if you want me to, why does there have to be so many distractions? Why does my flesh sometimes have to want to do things that are wrong? Why can't you just make it perfect? Right? Why does there have to be temptations in the world? Come on, God. You're making it hard on us here. But see, it's about a genuine heart move. Because when you truly love somebody, then you make a choice out of love. And it's not really love if it's easy. Sometimes it's hard, and it's that hard choice. It doesn't feel good in the moment, but let me tell you, when you make it, there's almost like a release, and you feel a drawing near. God begins to become closer, and you might even sense his presence more, be more sensitive to him. You might walk in a room and see somebody in pain, and before you would just look at him and be like, gosh, man, they need to get it together. They're got problems, and you just go about your business and your day. But see, when you're walking with heaven, with God in your life, you see that same person and you go, and all of a sudden you feel a feeling of compassion. You feel, whoa, what's that? I know they're going through something. And then a courage and a boldness wells up on the inside of you. And you walk up to him, hey, what's your name? I can see you going through something. Maybe God gives you a word of knowledge. Where you walk up to him and you say, hey, this might sound crazy, but I felt God speak to me and to tell you this. And then they go, what? Oh, right? And they just lose it because you hit them right in the spot. Who wants to be used like that? Who wants God to use your life? Come on. There should be more hands up in here. Come on. We don't want a dead church. And I don't want to fill a room with a bunch of dead people and be like, look at all the people we have here. And then they leave the room and they do nothing for God. They don't have a passion and a zeal to do anything for him. They want to play a religious game. I don't want to, I got to have mercy and grace for people because sometimes I get impatient. But we need to, come on, we got to stir each other up. We got to move higher. And there's levels with God, right? There's levels where we can step higher and go deeper and get to know him even greater. We can spend time with him and get to know him. Amen. All right, let's go to 1 Samuel 16. Then one of the servants answered and said, look, I have seen the son of, this is talking about David. We're talking about the key of David. What is the key of David? The key of David was David's disposition, his heart for God. I truly believe that key of David is that seeing David and how he lived and his desire to please God and his responses and how he lived is a key of how we're supposed to live and the attitude we're supposed to have for God. You know, there's a lot of parents who are Christians, who are religious, and they name their kids after Bible names, right? I met a lot of Davids, and you find out, oh, my name's David because my dad likes the character David. But let me tell you, you're not going to be like David unless you have a heart like David. Just because you have his name doesn't mean anything special. You got to have his heart. And that heart that truly loves to worship God. Look, I have seen a son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite, who is skillful in playing. So one thing about David is David was a worshiper. He spent a lot of time out with the sheep. And in that time he was with the sheep, he was worshiping God. I mean, those sheep had a special, right? A shepherd, because they got to sit there, eat, and go bah, and then listen to music. Oh, bah, and they're hearing like harps and whatever he's playing, you know? Something about music. Have you ever seen animals and how they respond to music? It's really interesting because they can hear it. They can get in tune with the melody, and there's a melody that comes from heaven. There's a heavenly sound that has the presence of God on it. You can listen to all kinds of music, rock music, rap music, and it's just, right? Some of it's bad. It influences you in a bad way. Sometimes you listen to rap, all of a sudden you want to walk around, you're looking for a fight because it's like, poof, 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 what's up, man? Right? Rock and roll. You're like, yeah, rock and roll. And you want to go out and just like drink and just get wasted. Yeah. All those rock stars. Let's do a bunch of coke and go to this show, man. Yeah. Some of our old rockers here. Some Van Halen. Remember that song? Jump, jump. Anyways, when you listen to worship, heavenly music, it can move your heart and move and tenderize your heart to God. And next thing you know, you feel his presence. You feel he fills the room. There's a guy by the name of Dappy T. Keys that's on YouTube that I like to listen to when I pray because he plays the anointed piano. I play it here during the week when we do our prayer time. Because I feel God's presence on his playing. And it makes me feel closer to God when I get around him. And that's what David did when he was worshiping. And Saul had him come in and play. And Saul had this distressing spirit because Saul was one of those guys who was called and was, hey, I'm a Christian. I'm here for God. But he wasn't truly surrendered and having intimacy with God. He disobeyed God. He didn't do what was right. And God found his replacement in David. 1 Samuel 13:13 says this, and Samuel said to Saul, you have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever, but now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be commander over his people because you have not kept what the Lord commanded. So I believe, you know, there's mercy and grace. We're not living under the Old Testament, but that there truly is when, you know, we have a relationship with God, God does require obedience from us. It's a living relationship with an actual personality. God has a personality. He has a way of thinking and seeing things that differ from us. He's other than. He is highly exalted. He is, right? He's this incredible being, but he has a mind. He has a voice. I believe God has feelings. I believe he feels, right? When we can grieve his spirit, and we can also bless his spirit. And when we obey him, the Bible says it commands the blessing. And we're waiting for, you know, sometimes we're waiting for God, but God's waiting for us to be obedient to the thing he told us to do. And when we're obedient, there's a release. God loves when we're obedient. He loves when we do the right thing. And that's what getting to know God is about, walking with him. So that, like David said, I hide the word of the Lord in my heart that I might not sin against him. Because all of us that live on the earth are going to struggle with temptations and sin. And there's things that are going to come. And some of them, you might, in this room, people are addicted to things. They have strongholds. They have bondage in their life. And they're struggling and they're weighted down by it. But see, when you get close to God, God comes in and he frees you up. He breaks those bonds. He breaks that stuff off of you so that you can have a connection with him and a relationship with him. And then as we walk with him, he's going to talk to you. He's going to say, hey, go here. Hey, go speak this. Hey, this is the plan I have for you. And as we hear it, we say, okay, God, I'll do it. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And then sometimes we go, not right now, God. No, I don't feel like it, God. And then he's patient. He's kind. He's long-suffering. He'll let us say no a few times, and he'll let us kind of start to strave and start to backslide, start to move away from him. But let me tell you, you're going to feel it. It's going to show up in your life. It's going to show up in the depression and the weightiness, and all of a sudden you're going to feel all this stuff because you begin to distance yourself from him. Because there's no better place than to be with him and to be at peace and to be in right standing with God. Hallelujah. Let's go to, I believe this is 2 Samuel 24, and we're going to start in 21. Then Araunah said, "Why has my lord the king come to his servant?" And David said, "To buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague..." So in this story, there's this plague that has happened. Judgments come because David sinned by counting the people. He was looking and he was counting the people. He did a census and God didn't want him to do that. And so this angel of the Lord was released and this plague hit and all these people started dying. And so David quickly is like, oh my gosh, you know, and he repents and then he comes to bring an offering. So I'm going to get into some of these points here. The key of David, he was a worshiper. You see it in the Psalms. David had a heart after God. His heart was after God, but what did that produce in him? What was one of the things about David that was different? He was courageous. He was brave. He was bold. He was confident. David was a leader. He had this strength in him to command and to, right? He literally led armies and went into battle, and he would fight with his men. He wasn't back there like, all right, y'all fight. I'm going to sit back here and watch like Saul did, sitting in his tent looking pretty. You want to fight the giant? Come, wear my armor, right? No, David was different. He had a heart after God. He was quick to repent. We're going to see this here, and we also see it in the next verse I'm going to share. That's another thing about David's heart is when he messed up or when he made a mistake, he was quick to repent, quick to say, I'm sorry. Why has my lord the king come to a servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be withdrawn from the people. Now Araunah said to David, let my lord the king take and offer up whatever seems good to him. Look, here an oxen for burnt sacrifice and threshing implements and the yokes of the oxen for wood. All these, O king, Araunah has given to the king. And Araunah said to the king, may the Lord your God accept you. Then the king said to Araunah, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price, nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God without that which costs me nothing. David was a giver. You know, David actually supplied everything to build the temple. David provided resources for the construction of the temple, including gold, silver, bronze, iron, wood, and precious stones. The value of his gift is estimated to be around $20 billion. $20 billion in today's dollars. David's offering was a testament to his faith and gratitude and his recognition that everything he possessed came from God. To have a heart like God is to be one that is a giver. And let me tell you, David didn't lack for anything. David never asked, like, God, are you going to come through? No, God always was there for him. And David, he was a liberal giver. He says, I'm not going to just give something unless it costs me something. Have you ever given and it's just kind of like, you don't feel it. And then have you ever given and you feel it and you're like, I don't know if I should have gave that. Oh my gosh, what am I going to do now? Right? You're like, you want to give to God, and then the doubt and the fear comes in because you're like, this is all I got. What am I going to do? But see, it's a testament of faith and trust in God. And let me tell you, when you give out of that place, God will come through. God will show you that he's your provider. God will show you that he can do supernaturally what you can't do. He'll open doors for you that no man can shut. And he'll shut doors no man can open. God will give you keys that open doors. And that's his favor and his blessing on your life. But when we're stingy and we withhold and we try to control, and then we make ourselves our provider. And let me tell you, that's a weight that most people can't bear. And God never created you to bear it, because he's your provider. That's why we call him Jehovah Jireh, the Lord my provider. And it's a revelation you have to get. A lot of people get offended at this stuff because they think preachers just want their money. You know, I had those thoughts when I first came to the Lord and I saw these preachers, you know, they're driving nice cars and they're living what they call prosperity. And I'm like, oh, my money. And then I got a revelation of, wait a second. The blessing that's on this man's life came from God. And the blessing that's on my life is going to come from God. I don't want men's blessing. I don't want some man who's rich coming around going, let me be God to you. And I'll bless you as long as you do everything I say. And there's men like that. There's men like that who are manipulative because money can be power. It's all in our politics. Super PACs and people that say, oh, here, we'll give you our money, but push our agenda. Well, here, we're going to give you tons of money. Tons of money. We want to support you, but you need to do it this way. How freeing is it to give to God and support his cause? And be like, I don't need any of your money. I have his. I have access to his. And when things shift, because I look at, you know, jobs sometimes, what are they? They're the means by which you money comes into your life, but they're not your provider. If you see it that way, then you stress, oh no, what if I lose this job? I can't quit. I can't move forward. Because if I don't have this, then I don't have my means of supply. But God wants to break you free of that and realize that's a way that he can bring money into your life, but there are other ways he can do it. We just have to let him speak to us and get a dream and a vision from heaven and allow for us to grow. Maybe you have to go to school. You have to take a class here, and then that prepares you. And then guess what? Your means can expand and how money comes to you because you follow the Lord. But if you're just stuck in a rut and you're financially struggling and you're just right, because sometimes we live paycheck to paycheck and that thing becomes our Lord. That thing becomes a thing over our head. You need me. You need me to live. You need me or you're going to be poor. You're going to struggle. God wants to break that idolatry, that stuff off of our life to where we look at him and say, no, you're my source. And he can do the impossible. I've had it in my life many times, and strangers will come up, people I don't know, give money or somebody in a church service, right? Because I would say plant it in the Lord, puts it on somebody's heart. The Lord told me to bless you. The Lord told me to give you this. The Lord told me that you were in need. And sometimes I wasn't in need and people still were given, because the Bible says, when you give, you'll receive. Pressed, shaken down, running together, shall men give into your bosom. There is a reward for being a giver. Amen? Amen. And I think we're going to kind of go into that in the next coming up here. I want to really teach on the tithe and offering and give you a biblical view of it. Because when you get a hold of this thing, it'll change your life. It'll change. You may not even be here anymore in the sense of like living in where you're at. Because God can take you and elevate you and take you. I mean, the sky's the limit. Your dreams can come true with God. God's not somebody who's trying to crush your dreams. He's the dream giver, and he's the enabler and the one who anoints us to accomplish it. Amen. So we see that David was a giver. We see that he was a repenter. He would repent. Let's see, where am I at here? He said, let me get an offering that does not cost me anything. Let's go to, this is the part where David fails, right? He messes up. He's supposed to be at war, but he's at home on the balcony, and he's checking out Bathsheba, right? It's kind of, I always think this is a funny example, because David's just on his roof, and all of a sudden he's, I mean, what has he got, binoculars? I mean, what's this guy, you know, he's just like creeping out, and then he just sees this girl, and he's like, oh, Bathsheba, right? And that lust and that thing came over him, right? Because you could be in a place and have everything going, but your weaknesses, your temptations, it's not like all of a sudden your temptations go away. You can still be tempted. You can still deal with sin and struggle with stuff in your life as long as you're on the earth until we get to heaven and all that's put away. When you have this flesh, and the Bible even teaches, you know, it's not, you're drawn away, oh man, by your own desire. That's why I teach it. I don't teach people to blame the devil. I teach people to take responsibility for their sin and where they mess up. Now, the enemy can get in there and feed it, and right? He can lie to us, and he can send temptation. But ultimately, if we fall and we fail, it's not the devil's fault. It's our fault. So we take responsibility. We submit to God. We resist the devil, and he flees. And in this situation, David ain't resisting nothing. He's like, oh, Bathsheba, baby, baby, right? He sent a text to his soldiers. He's like, hey, hook me up, set me up. And he finds out that she's married and that her husband is one of his soldiers. But that doesn't stop him. No, right? He does a very dishonorable thing. And even when he brings a soldier home after he has an affair and he does the wrong thing, and then he tries to bring the soldier home. Well, the soldier's so... Right, because this is how David trained his men to be honorable. But yet here he is in a weak place and he's dishonorable. And he has the guy come home to try to make it look like, you know, hey, sleep with your wife. Because any soldier that gets home who's been at war, right? One thing on their mind is, I'm back home with my honey and it's time to get it on, right? It's been a long time. Woo! Come on, it's time to get it on. But this soldier's like, uh-uh. I'm not going to, far be it from me while my men are at war. I mean, that takes some strength. That takes a man who has integrity. And he doesn't. So then David says, okay, well, let's send him to the front line so that he'll be killed. So then, then that kind of takes that away. And he has him killed. And then here we pick it up in this scripture. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, and Nathan was the prophet. And he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank up together with him and with his children. I already read that part. I ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one of the wayfaring men who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had to come to him. So David's anger was greatly aroused because he's given him this kind of analogy and this story. But really the story he's speaking is about David and what David did. He's just using the lamb as an example. So David's anger was greatly aroused against this man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, this man who has done this shall surely die. He shall restore fourfold from the lamb because he did this thing and because he had no pity. So David's in this place of, right, religious, righteous. Oh, but then Nathan said to David, and that's funny too, because a lot of these religious guys who are very harsh and judgmental, you find out that they got dirt going on. They got stuff in their life. Because, right, sometimes when we're in that place and you got to fake it, you start faking it instead of being genuine and authentic. And David was always about authenticity, but as he started to sin, that it's like that leaven that came in of hypocrisy. And now he's actually the guy. So David, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die, and he shall restore fourfold from the lamb because he has done this thing and has no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. You're the guy. I'm talking about you. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping and gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have also given you much more. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? You have killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword. You have taken his wife to be your wife. Right? Covetousness. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not commit adultery. David's breaking the Ten Commandments. Sort of, and he's the guy with God, right? A man after God's own heart. But here he is showing that he's still a man. He's still flawed. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you from your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of the sun. I mean, that's pretty intense. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all of Israel, before the sun. So David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. However, because this deed you have given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. Right? He brought a reproach on the kingdom of God. The child also who is born to you shall surely die. Then Nathan departed, because he's talking about Bathsheba got pregnant, but he lost that child. He tried to get it back through praying and fasting, because he tried to, you know, he's like, God, no, please don't let this child die. You know, if you really study David, he had these ways of responding that were very unique. Think about somebody, if you're like, you know, a CEO, and somebody who's under you comes in and says, I know what you're doing. Usually one of those, you're fired, or they go, right, they cut you off. David could have been like, Nathan, off with his head, right? Right? He could have ordered the guards to take Nathan and murder him. And there's kings, I'm sure, in the Old Testament who would have done that because they were wicked. But David, in his heart, wasn't wicked. He wanted to repent and basically say, I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry for what I did. He rent his thing and got on his face. I have sinned. And David said to Nathan, the Lord has put away your sin. The child, and then I said, then Nathan departed to his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bore to David, and it became ill. And that the continuation of that story is for another time. But you see, the key of David, that all of us, right? David is a unique example in the Bible, but he's also an example for us to follow. He's an example put there for us to see a man who loved God, who worshiped God, who had all these characteristics that God actually found pleasure in. That when we love God with all our heart, when we actually want to please him, when we actually want to spend time with him and have a relationship with him, and it's not this religious, right, this religious thing. One thing I can't stand is religion. And when I say that, I'm not talking about all the different names of religion, even though there are many different religions. I'm talking about Christianity and Christians who are half-hearted, halfway in. They got a little toe in. They're not truly sold out. They have a mind assent to God. Oh, I love God. Yeah, I know Jesus. I gave my life to him 20 years ago. And you remember the moment where the conviction hit and you surrendered, but did you go all in with him? Did you lay your life down and pick up his life? Did you lay down the whatever it is that thought you were going to do, and you laid it down to do his call and his purpose? Did you bring him into those secret places of your life and let him have full control? You know, when you preach like this, sometimes it makes people mad because they're the religious ones. People who are living with God, they're amen and hallelujah because they're connected. But the ones that are halfway in, it'll make them mad. Dude, I don't have to live for God like that. Grace, grace. I just, you know, I live by grace. Like grace, 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 grace. Grace, 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 grace. And then we stand before him at the end of our life, and we have to hold account for everything we did, everything we said. He doesn't bring everyone in this room in a room and say, oh, here are all the people that went to Real Life Church, and let's judge them all. No, individually, he comes to each heart, to each one. And there's mercy and there is grace, okay? And that's how we come back to him. That's how we pursue him, is we come through that doorway of God's so loving and forgiving. And God, sometimes we, you know, please don't, right? That's the fear of the Lord. It's not that God's going to judge you or kill you, even though there's examples of it in the Bible, even in the New Testament, of people who did things wrong and then they're done. God judged it. You know, it gets scary sometimes. But if our heart is pure and we're genuine, I think we can, right? We come boldly to the throne of grace, and we just say, God, please help me. I need you. I'm struggling here. I don't understand this. I'm mad about this. I really hate that person. My mom, my dad, whatever it is, whatever the things are that come to choke out the life of God in you, you have to begin to be real and genuine with God and begin to allow him to heal your life. And then when you're healed, you feel closer to him. You wake up with his presence. You hear his whispers. All of a sudden you feel happy. Might have a song on your heart. Next thing you know, you're walking around singing. La, 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 la. Whatever worship song. It's just flowing. It's overflow. Right? You come to church. You're ready to worship. You're ready to give. You're ready to, how can I help? Right? You don't come in with a critical spirit, with an attitude. My wife made me come again. Right? I'm just doing it so she doesn't yell at me when I get home. I have to deal with her. God wants to truly show you who he is, but you have to want it. It's not going to come because your mom, your dad, your neighbor, somebody desires it for you. You have to start to desire and say, God, if you're real, then I want to live for you. I want to be like a David. I want to be like a Moses. I want to be one who walks with God. And when you see Moses, right, he got to go and hang out with God on the mountain and really see, right? He didn't even get to see his front, but he saw his back. And then he came off the mountain and his face shone. You can be with God and God begin to change your countenance. You can walk with God and there be like a glow on you, a Holy Spirit power of God on your life. And you walk into a room and all the demons know who you are because you hang out with God. They can go, oh my gosh, there's one of those Christians. Not the religious ones, right? The ones who, you find them out in the parking lot halfway through the service and they're having a cigarette break outside. And then you look at the sign, it says First Baptist Church of, those Baptists, they like to smoke outside. And that's not to say that, you know, like God's not going to hate you if you smoke, but it's not good for you. And it might affect your health, but it is a sign of, you know, come on, God can free you, deliver you. I've had to deal with stuff in my own life and God delivered me, but it came with me, with God breaking it off my life, but then having a revelation of, oh, I don't need this anymore. Oh, I don't really need this. I don't need this. And then the world and the devil, you need it. You need it. You need me. And you're like, no, I don't. And he's like, oh, I'm losing. But God's created you and given you a Holy Spirit so you can win, be a victor. Amen? Amen. Well, God, I just thank you so much for your word that went forth this morning. I thank you for the people in this room. I thank you, God, that we're stirred up. We're ready, God. We want you. We're seeking you. You said, seek my face, and your face, Lord, I will seek. I will pursue you with my whole heart. Help me, Lord. If there's ways in me, if there's things in me, if there's any wicked way, God, show me, reveal it to me so that I can lay it down. Show me how to live like you. Show me how to love like you. Give me your best, the best that you have for my life. God, I want it all. I don't want to miss out on a single thing that you have for me. My destiny, my future, my purpose. Let me fulfill everything, all the plan that you had for my life. Let me not fall short of it. In Jesus' name.
1, 2, 3, 6.
Let's celebrate. Come on, come on. Let's celebrate. Come
all the old people in the house.
Let's celebrate. Come on, come on. Let's celebrate. Come on. Let's celebrate. Come on, come on. Let's celebrate.
All one. All two.
Spirit of